My message in the moments that we have together is called Found, Forgiven, and Reconciled. And just as we get started, I need to remind you that tonight we are having a worship celebration. We are singing songs and we are celebrating our risen Savior. We are celebrating Jesus. The service will start at 5:30 p.m., so it's half an hour earlier. And from now on, the Sunday evening service will be just that half an hour earlier. But I'm excited about it. And whatever is going on in your life, wherever your spirits are at, this will be a place tonight that will lift your spirits, that will remind you that God is in control, that He's with you in whatever's going on. And I know it's just going to be a beautiful, beautiful time together. So encourage you to be here. And maybe there's a friend who you know is going through a tough time, or someone who just needs to be in the house of God tonight. Well, why don't you invite them along? So as I said, my message title, Found, Forgiven, Reconciled. Today we celebrate our risen Savior, Jesus. Now, there was a tradition in churches where the pastor, the reverend, the vicar, as some are referred to, would say, "He is risen." And the congregation would respond, "He is risen indeed." And I kind of like that tradition because it's, you know, we're all in it together. It's not just I'm up here telling you, it's that we're all celebrating Jesus because it's the same here. What He does is for all of us. Whether you stand on a platform, whether you're sitting in the congregation, wherever you are. So we're going to practice this. I'm going to say, "He is risen." And then you are going to respond because you mean it in your heart. "He is risen indeed." Are we ready for that? Okay, after three, one, two, three. "He is risen." I liked it. But I feel like you're a little more reserved than you need to be on Resurrection Sunday morning at the 11 a.m. service. You got to sleep in, so there needs to be a bit more life here. Are we ready for that? I mean, feel free. You can stand, you can shout, you can whatever you want to do. Here we go. After three, one, two, three. "He is risen." I like that. I like that. That felt far more alive, and that is a good thing. So we do serve a resurrected Savior, Jesus. Now, this is unique. This is unique to any other religion, because all religions will have a teacher, a prophet, a leader who will provide various truths that you live by, but only one, and that is Jesus, said, "Not only do you live by what I teach, but how I am, who I am, matters as much as what I tell you. In fact, I'm going to show you that by what I do, dying on a cross and then rising again." It is not just about what He teaches us. It is about who He is, how He lived, and the fact that He rose again that separates the Christian faith from any other religion, if you want to call it that, in the world. So the question for all of us on Easter Sunday morning, is this simply a religious observance? Or does this have some bearing, some real meaning to my day-to-day life? Does it mean anything to me personally, to my story, to my situation? We live in a world today that is, you know, consumed by a lot of stuff. We can have a lot of things, but at the end of the day, what do we have that has some real deep meaning to it? And can this story of Jesus have deep meaning to it? In fact, I was this week at a cafe, as I do follow my morning routine, and I'd been to the gym, I had my swim, and I'd gone to my cafe, and I was sitting there reading my one new Bible and having my frothy oat milk with a hint of coffee, as I do. Don't judge me, that's just what I do. I know there are coffee snobs out there who think that he has frothy oat milk with a hint of coffee, there's something wrong with him. But Jesus loves me and He loves you, whatever your coffee preference is. And there I am with my one-year Bible, reading through it, making a few notes, and a lady just sitting up from me says, "What are you reading?" And I said, "Oh, I'm just reading my one-year Bible." And she said, "Oh, okay." And I said, "Yeah, it's quite good when you read it like this because you get some of the Old Testament, which can be quite dramatic. And then you get some of the New Testament, which is all about the story of Jesus. And then you get some of the Psalms, which is quite poetic. And then you get a proverb, which is quite wise and gives you wisdom for the day." And she goes, "Oh, wow, okay, that's really cool." And then she said, "So are you religious?" And you know, I mean, it's a loaded question, isn't it? I didn't say who I was or where I was from, but what I did say was, well, I don't know whether I'd call myself religious, but I would say I'm spiritual. I said, because to me, you can have religion without spirituality. I said this to her, but I said, I don't believe you can be spiritual without having some form of religious observance. To me, it's the spiritual personal connection that comes first, and then out of that flows a religious observance. And she said, oh, that's interesting, and continued with what she was doing. No, actually, she was really awesome. We had a chat about different books and things like that we were reading. But I feel like sometimes we get it the wrong way around. The religious observance is what makes me right with God, but actually it's not that. I do the religious observance out of the fact that I understand I have been made right with God, and so therefore I want to be in the house of God, read His Word, and understand more of who He is and how He has called me to live. So the Bible is full of incredible stories, and on Easter Sunday, we're going to look at a few different elements, and we're going to hear three amazing stories on the screen of people's lives that have been impacted. The first story we're going to focus on from Jesus, though, is that at a time where there is tragedy, a time where there's real emotion, a time that ultimately ends in celebration and victory, but there is pain in the middle of it. And that is what the Easter story represents. There's tragedy, there's emotion, there's pain. Jesus goes and allows himself to be crucified. And all those who love him see this take place, and he's humiliated, and there's pain, there's confusion. And then on the third day, he rises again, which is also confusing. You know, for those who first see him and then others who are told of him, and it's like he rose again and we've seen him and all the rest. There is so much going on in this story. But here in the Gospel of John chapter 11, we're going to consider a story about how Jesus had a friend who died. His friend's name was Lazarus. And Lazarus had two sisters, Mary and Martha. Jesus firstly hears that Lazarus is sick before he's died. But he's not there. He's in another town, another village. He doesn't go immediately. He waits two more days, and when he finally gets to the place where Lazarus usually lives, he's not alive, he's died. And by this time, people are grieving. Mary and Martha, the sisters, are mad at Jesus. They're accusing him. They're throwing guilt on him. They're projecting all their pain on him. In fact, in John 11:32, Mary, it says, Mary reached the place where Jesus was, saw him, she fell at her feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. I mean, that's pretty heavy, isn't it? Someone tells you, if you'd been here, they wouldn't have died. There's a lot of guilt there for Jesus to take on. Jesus isn't just feeling that moment of pain, he's feeling all the pain because it's his friend, Lazarus, who's died. In fact, we read on, and there's a verse. It says, Jesus wept, John 11:35. Two simple words, Jesus wept. Jesus feels the pain of losing his friend. Jesus feels the pain of everyone around him. Jesus feels pain deeply. He feels your pain and mine. He feels the pain for the loss of his friend. He feels the pain of Mary and Martha. And in the middle of all of this, Jesus makes a statement not just about his friend Lazarus, but a statement about who he truly is and what he can do for anyone who believes in him. In the midst of pain and loss and tragedy and anguish, confusion and difficulty, Jesus is still clear about his mission, his purpose, the plan that God the Father has for all humanity. In John 11:25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? He's not talking about Lazarus. He's talking about all of us. Dead in our sins, separated from God. lost to a world that is trying so hard to make it work without God. That's the world we live in today. We're going to find a way to make it work, and who needs God? Because that's just going to constrict how I really should be able to live. And yet God had a plan all along that gives us real freedom. A world that has rejected Him, God still stepped into the middle of it in the form of Jesus. Steps in and says, I'm the resurrection and the life. And today we celebrate the Messiah who, as John the Baptist proclaimed, takes away the sins of the world. Jesus, who weeps for a lost friend, is God saying, I'm weeping with you. When you're weeping, I'm weeping. Jesus, who allowed himself to be brutally crucified, and he did allow himself to be that, is God saying, I'm broken for you so you can be healed. Jesus, who overcame the power of sin and death and rose again, is God saying, I gave up my freedom so you could know real freedom. Jesus, who took on all of our sin, is God saying, I paid the debt of sin so that you are forgiven and redeemed. And then we see Paul, who writes a whole lot of the New Testament, who had his own encounter with Jesus. Paul was a leader of the Jewish community. He was out to put to death Christians because they were proclaiming this story of Jesus, and he didn't like what was going on with any of that because it was taking people away from what he would believe to be the truth. And in the midst of all of that, he has an encounter with Jesus personally. And it profoundly changes everything about him. And in 1 Corinthians 15, 55, he writes this, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death. And the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gave us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. And again, he wrote to the Colossians, another church, he wrote to them in Colossians 2:13, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He's saying, you didn't deserve this. You couldn't make this happen. You weren't religious enough. You didn't have it together enough. You weren't of the right bloodline. You didn't have any that you have of what you need to be reconciled with God. He said, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Jesus, who was counted out by death on the cross, made a public spectacle of this by triumphing over the cross. This Jesus is personal in his approach and powerful in his mission. And today on Resurrection Sunday, we draw near to a personal Jesus, and we are changed by his resurrection power. So we're going to explore three stories, three individuals, and the power of Jesus as our risen Savior, and what he has done for them and what he offers us: freedom from our sin, our shame, our mistakes, our confusion, our hurt and our pain, and gives us the opportunity to find new life, a new way of living. We're going to talk about being found by God through Jesus. We're going to talk about being forgiven by God through Jesus. We're going to talk about being reconciled to God and others by Jesus. So let's begin with our first story of being found by God. This is Rhoda's story.
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. Eritrea was beautiful, found in East Africa by the Red Sea. People will say it's a culture full of hope, hospitality, brotherhood, and sisterhood. My parents were always part of church, and I loved to sing in the kids' ministry. But one day, that all changed. With a shift in government came less and less freedom. Church started to close slowly, and people would be taken for questioning, and you would never see them again. It was no longer safe for Dad to stay, so he had to move to Sudan, visiting us whenever he could. We were vulnerable, and that was no secret, a mom and three kids alone by herself. The home intrigation just kept coming and coming. And when the onslaught got too much, Mom had enough. She wasn't safe in her own country. Once the escape was in motion, the people transporting us demanded more money, and then more. We were at their mercy in a land that wasn't our own. Five of us sleeping on a mattress on the floor. And every time we lose the power in the house, I remember my mom would gather us together and make us recite Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. And then one day, finally, we were free and reunited with Dad. It was a breakthrough, really, but in Sudan, we were never really at home. Doubts about the goodness of God kept crepting in. Sometimes I actually wondered if he was there or if he was really listening to us. In a season of waiting, time goes really slow, and our season lasted 5 years. Eventually, our prayer were answered, and we resettled in Canada. We had safety, but in a new culture, you had to find your feet, your faith, and yourself all over again. When you finally get to settle down, that's when identity crisis creeps in. After everything I witnessed and experienced, God finally began to put dreams in my heart. But people were still dying. Eritrea was the same Eritrea that I left. Sometimes these dreams just felt so far away and very unrealistic. Over time, I felt drawn to come to Bible college. He said he's in it, so I just followed. One day, in the suburb of Sydney, in the midst of lockdown and online conference, sitting in my kitchen, just chilling, barely paying attention, to be honest, I heard a sound, the language of Eritrea, Tigrinya. And not just random sound, this was a voice that I knew. It was a voice of Helen. When Eritrea was mentioned, my heart just jumped. Hearing our story told, I realized my dreams also can come true. If Helen can be seen in this big world, it made me feel like we are found. We were always found, and now I knew it more than ever. Here I was on my own, in this foreign country, and this is where God actually met me. And not only that, but slowly I got to meet myself. What I found in Christ is bold, faithful, someone who's going to keep going even when things don't make sense. And I definitely acknowledge the bad and all the bad things that have happened in my life and in others' life, but nothing is bigger than God. He can resurrect anyone physically, spiritually, and psychologically. Surely His goodness and love will follow us all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. For me, that's where I'm found.
Isn't that beautiful? Rhoda's story. How amazing. Rhoda from Eritrea, Africa. I got a special place in my heart for Africa, and I love hearing Rhoda's story. Jesus found Rhoda when she thought she was alone and thought God no longer cared or was interested in her, and yet He came looking for her. And He does this for all of us in different ways. In fact, this is part of God's story. Right back at the beginning of God's story in Genesis, after Adam and Eve sinned and rebelled against God's plan in Genesis 3:9, God, who knows everything, still goes looking for Adam and Eve in verse 9 of Genesis 3. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" God still wanted, longed to be with those He created. And just like Adam and Eve, He longs to be with us. Even though we at times have rejected Him and failed and made mistakes and sins, Jesus said in John 15:16, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you." What amazing news that Jesus chooses you and me. It's not just that we went looking for Him. It's not just that you wandered into church today somehow looking for God. It's that He planned all along ways that He could meet with you. He's looking for us, longing to walk in relationship through this life. with us. And I'm reminded of the story that Jesus told of the prodigal son. And you may know this story. It's a story of a son who goes to his dad and says, "Dad, can I have my inheritance now?" And he's just a young guy, and the dad decides to give it to him. And so he takes the wealth that his father has built over many years, and he goes into the city and he basically just squanders it. He wastes it, and he just messes up so badly, and he's got nothing left, to the point where he ends up working for a pig farmer amongst the pigs. And even the pig's food starts to look good to him. That's how bad life has got. And Jesus tells us a story of the Father's heart towards his son so that we can understand the Father God's heart towards us. In this story, the father longs for his wayward son to return. A son who has messed up so badly, wasted the inheritance of his father. And yet the father is not waiting in judgment for his son's return, ready to highlight all his faults and his failures, but rather waiting in love for his son to return home. Home, a place where he is loved and accepted unconditionally. And we read about this in Luke 15, verse 20. Speaking of the son, it says, "He got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for his son and ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him." Here's this father, not waiting in judgment, but waiting in love. He doesn't stop there. This father celebrates his son's return. He doesn't hide his son away. He doesn't disown him because of his failure. He celebrates his return, and so does God with each and every one of us. In Luke 15, 21, it says, "The son said to the father, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it.'" They are not vegans. "Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and he is alive again. He was lost and is found." And so they began to celebrate. Today, my friends, Resurrection Sunday is a day of celebration. Jesus is our Savior, and He has made a way for every one of us to return home to the Father, to experience His unconditional love and grace, to walk in the freedom that comes from knowing Jesus, because He came looking for us. What a beautiful, special, significant day it is. And so now we're going to be encouraged by Ori's story. Ori was found and forgiven by Jesus, and it changed him.
I didn't grow up in church, but I did grow up in a happy family. We lived in a beautiful house with big gardens outside of Melbourne. Dad was a plasterer. He loved photography. He always made us laugh. He was Daddington, I was Orrington. Then, when I was 6, we lost Dad. I didn't fully understand, but I knew he wasn't coming back. I unconsciously closed myself off, and that was the start of a bad path. I got expelled from school, became aggressive and violent. By 20, I was dealing drugs, soon fell into addiction myself. My brother and cousin had become Christians. I saw a glimpse of what Jesus had done for them. They said maybe God could help me too. That Sunday, I found myself in church. I gave my life to Jesus, but God wasn't my priority. I was heading so fast in the wrong direction, I didn't know how to turn around. I packed my car, started driving to the Gold Coast, desperately hoping for change. Late one night, sitting in my car, I was brought lower than I thought I would go. I wondered if my life was over. But that's when I remembered, I'd already given it to Jesus. And I just said, "God, I gave my life to you. If you are real, reveal yourself to me. This isn't living, I need you." Right at that moment, I changed the radio station.
There's no hiding from your face. There's no striving.
It was the same song played in church the day I gave my life to Jesus. I felt a burden lifted, and God answered, and he said to me, "Yeah, life's been tough, but it doesn't have to continue like this." And at that moment, I knew he was real, and I broke down and cried. I hadn't cried in years. That Sunday, I walked through the doors of the church. I planned to get there right on time so I could sneak in and sneak out straight away. But my time management wasn't always the best. I got there 15 minutes early. I was pacing up and down the hallways. Then a guy came up to me and said, "Hey man, what's going on?" I just shared with him and he was like, "Do you want to come sit with me today?" I wasn't out of place. I kept turning up, still addicted. I knew it was wrong, but I never felt judged. It was a Friday night when I got baptized. All I knew is that I was publicly declaring my faith, saying goodbye to my old life, becoming a new creation in Christ. As I held tight to that revelation, I felt something shift. By God's grace, I was finally free from addiction, got a job, and found my way in life. I had a passion for helping people. I wanted to be a light, but I found myself caught up with the wrong crowd. 8 months after my mountaintop moment, I was back in addiction and away from church. My mental health hit rock bottom. I ended up in hospital for months. It was rough, but through it, God lit up the path that he knew I needed to take. In rehab, I began to mature and understand God's forgiveness. It's always been easy for me to forgive other people, but I'm so hard on myself. One day, the Holy Spirit prompted me, "Why don't you forgive yourself? The past is past. I don't have to keep repeating it." After that revelation, every day was fresh. I knew that I just had to keep on showing up and shaking the shame off. It's been a crazy couple of years, but being in church, going to Bible college, pursuing the dream of helping others gives me so much joy and hope. I know I wouldn't be where I am today if Jesus hadn't carried that cross.
Another beautiful story. A story of a changed life by Jesus. I love Ori's story. I think it can relate to so many of us, especially when he says, "It's always been easy for me to forgive other people, but I've been so hard on myself. One day the Holy Spirit prompted me, 'Why don't you forgive yourself?'" And maybe that's where you find yourself today. You're struggling to forgive yourself. You get down because of the regret you feel over your past. None of us can change our past. But the death and resurrection of Jesus reminds us that our past is forgiven and our future is secure with him and in him. And that's what baptism represents. We're going to baptize people tonight in our service, and it's going to be a beautiful, very powerful, significant moment. It is leaving the old nature, our old life under the water, and it is coming up as a new creation in Christ Jesus. Paul, again, writing to the church in Corinth in 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. You are a brand new person because of Jesus. The old has gone, the new is here." On Resurrection Sunday, we're reminded that our past is forgiven, and not just forgiven, it is washed away. And there is a whole new life with God waiting for us to explore, to enjoy, and to step forward into. We have a new life because Jesus' sacrifice restored our relationship with God, our Heavenly Father. But not only does he restore our relationship with God, but he also works to restore our relationships with each other. Let me read to you from 2 Corinthians 5 in the Message paraphrase from verse 16. It says, "Because of this decision, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and got it all wrong, as you know. We certainly don't look at him that way anymore. Now we look inside, and what we see is that anyone united with the Messiah gets a fresh start, is created new. The old life is gone, a new life emerges. Look at it. All this comes from God, who settled the relationship between us and Him and then called us to settle our relationships with each other. God put the world square with Himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of our sins. God has given us the task of telling everyone what He is doing. We're Christ's representatives. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. We're speaking for Christ Himself. Now, become friends with God. He's already a friend with you. How beautiful is that? Become friends with God. He's already a friend with you. God is all about reconciliation of relationships. Firstly, ours with Him, and secondly, ours with each other. We have one final crazy, inspiring story to shed some light on God's ability to reconcile relationships. Let's enjoy this together.
I was a 60s girl, just 17, when Fred drove us to a party one night. Now, Fred, he wasn't flashy like other guys I'd gone out with. He was calm and composed, a bit of a closed book. I'm all about communication, and who doesn't like a challenge? Now, he liked that I was fun and a bit of a leader. Later, he would say that I made him feel comfortable being himself. But the truth is, I wasn't comfortable being me. On the outside, I looked great. But on the inside, life had broken me. I'd grown up knowing about a God. Somewhere out there, he knew me, but I definitely didn't know him. So Fred and I didn't get married in a church. Instead, I arrived at the registry office in my white velvet suit that my big sister had made, and we signed the paperwork and went shopping. And then we had our precious daughter, Jane, who brought us so much joy. Throughout this season, Fred was amazing, but there was communication breakdown, compounded by my insecurities, and real challenges in family and life. If you don't give things attention when they need it, they don't work. We filed for divorce and started building separate lives. I was then diagnosed with cancer. I was so cross. I found myself alone and heading for a lumpectomy. I felt a complete failure. I was divorced, I was sick. I felt, I can't do this, but I was stubbornly resolved to make it on my own. But Fred, being Fred, of course, he offered to move back in and look after Jane while I was in hospital. When sickness takes your life to its limits, it leaves you wondering, what if this had been the end? When I came home from hospital, we had a very real conversation. And Fred asked, as he does, the real questions. What do you want to do? The truth was, I wanted to travel around Europe in a camper van. So we went, the three of us. On our travels, we crossed paths with Americans who invited us to church. There was no way I was going, and neither was Fred. But you know what? In the end, their kindness led us there. They were just so kind. The man at the front of the church, who was not even wearing a white collar, claimed to have heard from God. Seemed like madness. And when the service was ended, he invited people to come forward to the altar. I closed my eyes, resting assured that calm and composed Fred wasn't going anywhere. But then I felt him get up. Opening my eyes in disbelief, I saw Fred making his way to the front, with Jane close behind him. I was like, no way are they going to heaven without me. Now, I got up for all the wrong reasons. But by the time I reached the front, wonderful Holy Spirit touched my heart. And I knew, I really knew I had a Saviour. His amazing grace. How sweet the sound that you could save a wretch like me. I once was so lost. But now I'm found. I was so blind. But now I can see. We were baptized in the sea with our past washed out in the waters. And we were reconciled to Christ as a whole family. Finally, I could say it is well with my soul. And if your soul is well, you can face anything. We read our Bibles cover to cover, cover to cover. I prayed in tongues for days at a time. We saw healings in church and miracles in our own lives. Decades later, Fred is still calm, sees what I don't see. He tells me the truth and also releases me to be me. He knows I love him unconditionally. Our second wedding was all about Jesus, a dedication to walk out salvation together. Even if it got difficult, we made that choice right there that we would never, ever do it without him. Because you know, those who've been forgiven much really do love much. And being reconciled for me means forgiveness, being found, having true hope and eternal salvation. It was grace that brought us safe thus far. And you know what? It's his grace that will lead us home.
Again, isn't that a beautiful story? How good. Margaret and Fred. I don't know if Fred and Margaret are here anywhere. Where are they? Oh, so good. Married twice. Well done, Fred. I love that Fred just sits there and thumbs up. I think Margaret does most of the talking in that relationship. Fred just thumbs up. I don't know if Rhoda is here or Ori, I'm not sure. Is Rhoda here? Can you stand, Rhoda? Beautiful. I'm not sure if Ori's here or... He's serving in kids. What a legend. Deserves a round of applause as well. I love Margaret's final words. Those who've been forgiven much, love much. Being reconciled for me means forgiveness, being found and having eternal salvation. It was grace that brought us home. Sorry, grace that brought us safe thus far, and it is grace that will lead us home. We celebrate on Resurrection Sunday because we have a risen Savior. He is personal, yet he is powerful. He looks for us because he loves us, and we are found in him. He forgives us because he wants to know us and walk through this life with us. He reconciles us because without him we mess up, but with him we can journey well through this life. With Jesus we build healthy lives, healthy relationships, and we live for something greater that he in his wisdom and grace designed our lives for. Jesus, what a wonderful Savior. What a beautiful Lord. That is who we celebrate today. And I want us right now to stand to our feet if we would. And can we put our hands together and thank Jesus for all that he has done for us. Amen. I'd love it if we could just bow our heads and be in a moment of prayer. Father God, we just thank you for Jesus. We thank you that we are found in him and we are found by him. Jesus, we thank you that it's you that forgives us, gives us a brand new start, Lord. You guide us and lead us through this life. You want to walk with us, reconciled to you. You want to help us to be reconciled to each other. We thank you, Jesus, for all that this day represents, the good news that it brings, the hope that it brings, the future that stirs within us, the understanding that we matter and our lives are of immense value to you. And therefore, they matter to this world. We have a part to play that you have designed and called us to. And just with heads bowed and eyes closed, it would be my privilege to pray with people here or joining us online who say, you know what, Phil, I've been away from God and I don't want to live like that anymore. I want to know him. I want to walk with him. My friend, he loves you. And you can begin a brand new walk with God today simply by praying a prayer, a really simple prayer. And I'd love to pray with you, a prayer of surrender, a prayer that says, Jesus, forgive me. Give me a brand new start. And I believe that's exactly what he'll do. Maybe at one point you were walking with God, but you've left that place and you've been doing life on your own. And you know you need to come back into right relationship with God today. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you want to be part of this prayer, what I'm going to do, I'm going to count to three. And when I get to three, if you want to be included in this prayer, you just lift your hand wherever you are and I'll see it, acknowledge it. Together, we'll pray right where you're standing. And online, you just let us know in the chat you want to be part of this prayer. One, God loves you. Two, have the courage today to say yes to Him. Three, just lift your hand wherever you are. Say, that's me, that's me. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Beautiful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All around, I can see hands being raised. God bless you over here and up through here and here. Just lift your hand. That's you today. Say, that's me. Been away from God. I don't want to live like that anymore. Beautiful, beautiful. We're going to pray together. And like I say, you can join us also online. Let us know. We're going to pray with you. But if your hand's raised, if you lifted your hand, we're going to pray together. And as a church family, we're all going to pray this prayer. And you can just say this simple prayer from your heart after me. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for everything He's done for me. And right now, I open my heart, my life, everything I am, and I give it to you. I thank you. From this moment, I am forgiven. I'm a child of God. I'm leaving the past behind, and I'm walking forward into my future with Jesus as my Lord, as my Savior, as my friend. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's congratulate everybody who prayed that prayer. And whether you prayed that prayer online, let us know, or you're here in the auditorium and you lifted your hand, prayed that prayer. We want to give you a gift. It's a New Testament of the Bible. It's a really easy translation of the New Testament of the Bible for you to read. And this will be available at all the doors as you leave. Someone is waving this. So you just grab one, say, I need one of those. And even if you came today, you don't have a Bible, we'd love to give you one of these as a gift from us to you on this very special Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. So make sure you grab hold of that. Come on, can we congratulate again everybody who prayed that prayer? Well done.